you are going to enjoy the show tonight because we have a guest tonight, and our guest is Michael Goldman. Good evening, Michael.
Good evening, Tom.
Okay, let me just turn you down a little bit there. And Michael's here. Michael's working on hard at work on doing translations of the famous Danish poet Benny Andersen, if I've pronounced that correctly. I don't know if I have.
No, that's pretty good. That's pretty good, Tom.
Pretty close?
Yeah.
Okay, and Michael's going to read some poetry for us, and he has some music. In fact, that first cut we heard tonight was an original recording by Michael. And what's the name of that song, Mike?
That's called Mirror Images.
Mirror Images. And you recorded that in a studio with another fellow playing drums, and you played...
I played the clarinet and the keyboard, and I wrote the tune as well.
Yes. Yeah. And that's a nice little tune to start off the show with. Michael's an accomplished musician and composer and poet and writer. And this latest project of his has taken him over the big pond, as they say.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So what can you tell us about it, Michael?
Well, I began translating Benny Andersen's poetry almost 2 years ago. It's amazing how time has gone by. Just for fun, really. Just because I read his poetry in Danish, and I loved it, and I wanted to share it with my friends and family, and so I started translating just a few of them, I found more and more that I loved, and I started doing more and more, and it just grew and grew, and now. You can see the book that I've been working out of.
Yes.
Benny Andersen's
been very thick. The people in radio land, this book is probably about 3.5 inches thick or 4 inches thick.
It's about 1,200 pages of poetry. I've translated maybe a quarter of it or a fifth of it at this point. And I'm having a great time, and I'm really happy to be here to talk about it and to share some of the poems on the air.
Is your goal to translate all of Benny Andersen's poetry, or
that's almost like a
lifetime project, I would think.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's possible.
Yeah,
because I mean it's a great goal, and I do want to translate as many poems as I'm excited about. But yet, I've run into dead ends on some of them because some of them are just really difficult or what seem to be impossible to translate just because of the cultural differences and the wordplay that he uses. So I'm not sure that I can do that, but I will. You know, I'm not done yet. I'm still translating. I was working on some yesterday, so it's still in progress.
What you can do is pick out the ones that you like and are possible to translate. Translation is a complex and delicate art form, and not everybody's good at it. And sometimes you can ruin poetry in translation, but it takes the right touch, I think, to go from one thing to another.
So I'd like to talk more about Benny Andersen and his work, but I thought I should read one to give our listeners a sample. One thing that he often does is that he'll take a very simple, mundane, common daily task. He'll start his poem with something very mundane, he'll use some fantasy and some wordplay, and suddenly you're in some place very deep and maybe even over your head. And he does that in this poem as well. This is called The Time. What time is it, you ask? Quarter past, the nearest past. A couple of minutes in the future, long past that time when the children were small and it was long past their bedtime, long past Wee Willie Winky when the time was constantly past 8. The time is not a time. It is many. It is one. The time is a slave driver. The time is a saving angel. The time is a clown. The time is maybe 15 minutes ahead. The time you can't count on. The time doesn't follow time. The time doesn't care about time. The time undermines time. Like the ant lion on the bottom of its sand crater where busy ants skid down. The time is a lifted eyebrow, a finger on the lips, a kiss on the tired forehead. The time is almost nothing. The time is only barely inside of us, as long as we give ourselves plenty of time for one another.
Nice. Really nice. So you did the translation of that piece.
Yes.
Yeah. Would you, I don't know about this, but would you consider reading a piece in Danish too? Like we could compare. I mean, people won't understand it, but the sound of it might be interesting for people. Well, do you do any of that too?
I could. But we're gonna have Benny Andersen.
Oh, we got read plenty
one.
Of stuff today.
We're gonna have one in Danish in a little bit.
Okay.
What I really loved about this poem. A friend of mine gave this to her son at his graduation.
Yeah.
Because part of what this poem does, it talks about the time, like the clock on the wall, mm-hmm. but then it also talks about time, which is very different
yes.
than the clock on the yeah. wall. And a lot of times our lives are guided by the time,
yeah.
but we forget about time.
Right.
And that's what he's reminding us of here.
Yes.
That let's not just think about the time and where we need to be and what we need to do, but let's remember time and how time. Valuable that is. And the time that we give to one yeah. another, which is not on the clock.
Yes, the most precious thing. The precious gift that we have is time.
So he starts with something very mundane. What time is it, you ask? Mm. And then he reminds us at the end that what really matters is time, not
yeah.
the time.
No, yeah.
So anyway.
I like that.
Nice.
I like that a lot.
So you want to hear some Danish. So instead of me reading the Danish, we'll have Benny Andersen read the Danish.
I like that.
I just want to say a little bit for people who don't know much about Benny Andersen. He just turned 83 years old, and he is definitely the premier living poet in Denmark. His work is studied in all the schools. He tours regularly through Denmark, both for readings and also for performing. He's a celebrated pianist and composer and songwriter. And he just did a series of sold-out concerts, yes, at the age of 83.
Wow.
He's also written children's books. He's written for TV, for film, he's won pretty much every literary prize in his country. But he's very little known in the U.S., and I'm really happy to be here with you, Tom, to be able to spread his work a little further.
I'm so glad you can share it with us. You were telling me that his book, there, his collected poems – sold over 150,000 copies in Danish.
That's right. And this is a brick of over 1,200 pages.
Yeah.
So this has landed in many, many, many homes throughout Denmark.
Yes.
His work is very well known. Some of his songs are sung in schools and churches, at weddings, funerals. He's really out there in the population. People yeah. know him. Maybe comparable would be maybe like Robert Frost. At the height of his popularity, yeah. Very, very, very well known.
Yeah.
He's just he's a national treasure,
yeah.
and I'm really, really thankful to be able to work with him.
Yeah. Like a Robert Frost or a Carl Sandburg or yeah. a Bob Dylan, somebody
right, exactly.
that has that sort of cachet.
Yeah, and when you say Bob Dylan, Benny Andersen is also a songwriter.
Right.
One of his big CDs sold over 500,000 copies in Denmark. Considering there's only 5 million people in Denmark, that's like one out of every 10 people.
It's unbelievable.
So it's very popular. So how about if we listen to him read this next poem? This poem, in English, it's called Happiness. In Danish, that's Lykken. And he does repeat a line. You can listen for it. It's the first line, and also he repeats it towards the end. He says, Der er noget særligt ved Lykken. There's something special about happiness, he says. Yeah. So you'll hear him say that. Let's hear Benny Andersen.
This is Benny Andersen reading Happiness.
Lykken. Der er noget særligt ved lykken. Man kan blive helt glad, når man møder den, men også beklemt, står stille lidt, lister sig så varsomt frem, som i et minefelt. Og hver gang man sætter foden ned, uden at ryge i luften, glemmer man enten at nyde lykken, eller bliver sur over ikke at vide, hvor længe den varer. Så når modgangen endelig melder sig, er det en lettelse, som om man er kommet i sikkerhed. Det er nu skammeligt, for der er noget særligt ved lykken, som man ellers ikke møder. Måske ligger fejlen der. Man kender for lidt til den. Burde sætte sig mere ind i den. Jeg tror, det er en træningssag.
So that was Benny Andersen reading Happiness in Danish.
Right. So let's hear the English now.
Okay.
So this is my translation of happiness. There's something special about happiness. You can be really glad when you feel it, but also anxious. You freeze for a second, then slowly step forward, cautiously, like in a minefield. And every time you put a foot down without being blown up, you either forget to enjoy your happiness or you're upset over not knowing how long it will last. So when adversity finally makes its appearance, it's a relief, like you've made it to safety again. It's a shame, because there's something special about happiness that you don't otherwise come across. Maybe that's the problem. We don't know it well enough. Should learn more about it. I think it's a matter of training.
Yeah, that's an interesting idea.
He's taking the idea of happiness. Everybody has the pursuit of happiness.
Right.
Like, this is
yeah.
a big thing. This is it what
is.
We all want.
It's in the Constitution.
And yet that moment when you feel happy, you think, oh my God, this is it.
Yeah.
And it's like a crisis. And so what he's saying is, yeah, does it have to be that way? Or can we get used to happiness? Can we get used to being happy?
I don't know.
It reminds me of a something that Thoreau wrote. Yeah. It says from Walden, where he says, we're always searching and looking for something that's important to us. And when do we find it? When we're sitting at the table with the whole family there.
Mm-hmm.
He says, you search for something half your life, but then when you find it, you become its prey.
Ah, yeah.
And I think that's kind of what Benny Andersen is getting in at here.
Yeah.
And that, anyway, so that's yeah. happiness.
Yeah. So do you think that an insight into the poetry is essential for making a good translation? That you became a fan of Benny Andersen's work, and you felt the desire to share it with your family and friends. Now, your wife is Danish.
That is correct.
And you've been to Denmark many times.
And I also lived there for 2.5 years.
So you have one foot here and one foot there, so to speak, yeah, in some yeah. ways.
That, right.
But that would be unusual, especially in the United States. I don't imagine there is a great, huge Danish community here.
There isn't. I understand there are a couple of smaller Danish enclaves yeah. on the West Coast, but I'm sorry I've never been there, so I can't tell you firsthand.
And so to share the poetry with your friends, because you're like, this stuff is great. I got to like read some of this stuff. You decided, if I can just translate this and capture the sentiment, the meaning, the perspective of it, the humor, some of the word interaction, the wordplay, then I can share it with my friends and they're going to like it because I like it.
Yeah.
I want to turn them on to this stuff.
That's exactly it. Yeah. I loved it. And part of what I love about Benny Andersen's poetry is that it's very colloquial. He uses everyday speech and everyday situations, and it's something that everybody can relate to.
It's wonderfully accessible, and it's almost interactive in a way, because mm-hmm. it hauls you in and it kind of twists you around and makes yeah. you think about stuff. Yeah. So,
but just because it's accessible, doesn't mean that it's simple.
It's very intricate.
It's and deep.
Yes.
And yeah. and that's what I love about it. So I'd like to say a little bit about some of, well, I don't know. Do you want to play a piece of, do you want to go?
Oh, we can go to a piece of music here if you want.
And then I can tell a little bit more what I've been doing lately with it.
Let's see what else we got here keyed up from your CD.
Do the first cut.
Well, I just stopped for a visit, like I do from time to time. And I wonder now, what is it that keeps me coming back? You've had ups and downs that I can hardly measure, but to see them on you now gives me such pleasure. Your everything is showing, your everything is showing, your everything is showing. Your everything is showing. Your heart's on your sleeve and your words on your lips. Your eyes there on mine and your hands on my hips. And your everything is showing. Your everything is showing. Your everything is showing. I think I know where this is going.
Okay, welcome back. You're listening to Twilite's Poetry Pub on WXOJLP Northampton, 103.3 FM, Valley Free Radio, streaming worldwide at valleyfreeradio.org. Tonight's guest is Michael Goldman, and we are talking Benny Andersen poetry. But first, Michael, that was another original composition from you.
Yeah, that's called, obviously, your Everything is Showing.
Your Everything is Showing. Yeah. Somewhat reminiscent of Leonard Cohen in my thinking. The voice,
well, thanks. Okay. That's a compliment.
The phrasing, somewhat reminiscent. Of course, your own style, but it reminded me a little bit of that. The nice lyric, the meaningful interplay of the words. It was good. Good
thanks
stuff.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah. So now you're going to share with us some more poetry, I think.
Yeah, well, since when I was here last year, I had probably translated about 80 poems or something. And since then, a lot has happened. Benny Andersen invited me to come meet with him, and I did. So I was in Denmark in the summer, and I was nervous because he was, you know, he was a big hero.
Right.
I've been working, and I was,
I would have been a little starstruck myself.
So. And I was, but my wife and I drove up to his house outside Copenhagen, in one of the suburbs, and he brought us right into the kitchen and sat down, and we started going over the translations that I had sent him through the mail, one by one. No, he didn't. No, not too much pleasantries.
No preliminaries, right into it.
And some of them, you know, he would just check off, this one's fine, you know, throw it on the floor. Next one, oh, we're missing some commas here. All right, done with that one. And then, but sometimes there'd be a word that I don't think this quite captured what I meant.
Yeah.
And so we would work, my wife was working the dictionary, the Danish English dictionary, and we were coming with some new ideas, and we found something that we agreed on, and okay, move on to the next one. And we had a great time.
Yeah.
We had a really great time. We were there for about 4 hours, having lunch. His wife made us lunch. And then he said, can you come back? And I thought he was going to say maybe in 6 months or so. But he said, well, how long are you in Denmark? And we were going to be there for another week. He said, well, how about you come back on Friday? And I was, okay, we'll be here.
Perfect.
And we went through another 20 or so translations that day, too. We played music together. We socialized and generally had a great time.
That is really – it's just it almost sounds dreamlike in that it was so cool.
I don't see how it could have been any better.
Yeah.
By the time we left, he was shaking my hand and calling me his partner, and we're both looking forward to seeing something happen as far as a publication here in the U.S.
Yeah, because essentially what you're talking about is a guy who's a living legend in Denmark. Maybe he's not known in the United States, but in his own world, he is a living legend. And you're coming in here from America, oh, here we go.
Yeah.
But right into it you got, and got some work done, and still working on it. You were on the show. I want to bring the listeners up to snuff here. Michael was on the show almost exactly a year ago, and this project was more of a gleam in the eye. It was in its infancy at the time, and now it's moving toward fruition, and it's building. It's like its own thing moving forward now. It's really becoming something. So we're very excited for Michael and his work, and it's a good thing.
So after returning from Denmark, I did a couple of things. With the advice from Ellen Watson, who's a professor at Smith.
Yeah, she's good.
She recommended that I join ALTA, which is a National Literary Translators organization, which I did, and went to their conference and met hundreds of people from all over the country that also translate literature, poetry from other languages into English. And I had a great time.
Mostly professors, I would believe.
Yeah, there weren't. I mean, I've been working full time as a contractor carpenter. There weren't two. You know, I was definitely in the minority.
Yep.
But we share the love of literature and of cross cultural interpretation, and they were very. You know, it was really a great experience. I learned a lot. Met friends that I'm still. Yeah. Contacting with people, giving me advice, who have been down this road before to help me through. So it was a really great, great experience.
Yeah, that's really a good thing, and the fact that you bring a different perspective of life rather than just a academic perspective makes this even more meaningful. I mean, speaking from my own perspective, as someone who's worked as a firefighter and an EMT. And also worked as a carpenter for a time. You're building things with your hands, or you're working with people every day. Stanley Kunitz would say that's a good thing.
Yeah.
Don't just bring poetry to poetry. Bring some life experience to it. Do something. Build something. Make something. Be something other than just a poet. And it's more real that way.
Another thing that I've been doing is I've started submitting these to get them published, because Benny Andersen gave me permission to publish them, and I believe that the very first publishing of these translations is going to come out of Northampton, the Bateau Press, which is a small press in Northampton, accepted three of my translations. They'll be dual language. They'll be printing the Danish across from the English, so people can read both, and that should be coming out soon. I think we've read the last proofs, and this is I'm going to read one of the poems that that they accepted. This is called Spirit. And when I talk about him starting in the mundane, there's not much more mundane than this. This poem begins with peeling potatoes, but this is called Spirit. Do we put too much emphasis on material things. When I sit and peel potatoes, especially new potatoes, I can suddenly stop and think, good God, what in the world are you doing? And I look at the potatoes, see something in them. Every single little potato is an independent being with eyes and skin and 1,000 latent possibilities, just like yourself. Really, think about it. And I look out in the sun, think about my life, consider again the small defenseless ones that I have come to respect. It can be a long time before I start peeling again. This is what I mean by spirit.
I love that piece. That's great. It was really good. Spirit, Benny Andersen, translation by Michael Goldman and read by Michael Goldman. Okay, so you got one more for us right now?
Sure. This is one more that Bateau Press is going to be printing. Should be coming out shortly. And this is called Sleepyhead. Impossible, immense morning when you never get out of bed or only reach its outer edge. It's so extensive, the size of a county. You burrow your way under a clammy, low-hanging comforter, single stray spermatozoa. Don't have the stamina to make it through. Have to stop, catch your breath and your nerve. Now no sweaty panic on the sheets. There are still untried folds to follow. No traffic to watch out for. They are waiting for you out there at the comforter border with questions, meetings, slippery slopes, neckties. They are waiting for you to wake up. It is your duty to dig your way out once a day and show yourself. Eat a little, grow a little, show up and wait your turn. Stretch yourself, bend, sign something or dance, take a position, take in something, take part. But my movements go weak from all this comforter that stretches before me like a glacier. What can be transmitted through down? Send out a felted telegram to fidgeting superiors, tea-clattering near and dear ones, on-duty pedagogues and creditors. I am alive, but have been debilitated. Start a search with radar, frogmen, St. Bernards.
Cool. And that one is titled...
That is called Sleepyhead.
Sleepyhead. what does that translate to in Danish?
Well, it's funny you ask that, because that goes right into the kind of the heart of the translation process. There, you can't say sleepyhead in Danish. What the poem is called Sovsover, which if you were going to click on, you know, Google Translate or you know, like a translate program, it would translate as seven sleeper. But that's not it.
No.
Because when you call someone a sovsover, you're calling them in English is a sleepyhead. So that's the job of the translator sometimes, is to take an expression that you can't directly translate and say, what does this mean? We're not translating words here.
No.
We're translating the meaning.
Meaning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And sometimes on top of that, you not only have to translate the meaning, but there's layers of repeated sound,
right.
Rhyme.
Right.
There's rant. There's also layers of a repeated motif. So there's other the musicality of the poem. There's other things to take into consideration.
There's a lot of nuance that you have to account for, and it's very, very challenging and intricate to translate. I've tried my hand a couple times at a few different things. Now I don't speak any other languages. That's not always necessary for translation, but it sure does help. But you can look at things and try and devise the meaning from it. by doing using things like Google Translate. I've tried my hand at some. I'm a big fan of Irish poetry, and I've tried my hand at a few of these, and I'm like, but I don't have anyone to compare or ask about. Well, how does this one look? I just go, geez, you know, this seems to capture something. It seems like it's good, but I don't know. You know, I don't know how close it is or if it even matters.
So I learned Danish as an adult. I was 19. It was my second visit to Denmark, and I wanted to impress my girlfriend and her family. We've now been married for almost 23 years.
Guess it worked.
So it worked. But even though I've been speaking and reading Danish for 25 years, I wasn't brought up there.
No.
And so I do run into turns of phrases, metaphors that I'm not sure of.
Yeah.
And thank God for my wife Yetta, because yeah. I can say to her, you know, did I get this right? And she'll help me out.
Yeah.
So it's really a lot of translators have that, that they have a native person that they
right.
work with to just to keep track. They don't to make sure they don't get off track.
Yeah. So Yetta, that's a shout out to you, right there. Oh boy. Do you want me to read this one here, or maybe we should play another song first, or something?
Either way.
All right. You know, I'm going to give it a whirl. And here is a translation by Michael Goldman of a poem by Benny Andersen entitled Diet. Shrimp, dry out your corneas. Fat gives you pimples. Pancakes lay too flat in your stomach. Pork isn't good for your heart. Fish isn't good for the butcher. Chicken isn't good for the chicken. Meatballs aren't good for anything. Avoid sago soup during pregnancy. Avoid onion during marriage. Sweet is sinful. Sour is dangerous. Salt shortens your life. Bitter makes it drag on. Marmalade gives you droopy ears. Stew constricts your air bladder. Eggs make your arms go crooked. Cheese affects your sense of smell. Horseradish affects your sense of taste. Cookies affect your hearing. Radishes diminish the horizon. Peas arrest your development. Cauliflower spoils the view. Breakfast spoils your appetite. Bedtime snacks sharpen it. Food is not good for your stomach. Life is unhealthy. Chomp, chomp, chomp. Benny Andersen, Diet, translated by Michael Goldman. So that's a funny sort of a piece. I mean, I was laughing reading it a little
bit.
Me
too. Even though I translate, I still laugh when you're reading it.
Yeah.
I love how it kind of picks up speed.
Yeah.
You know, just with the repetition, and where he's just making fun of our culture.
Yeah.
That you know every time you turn your head, oh no, that's bad for you, or that's bad for you. Something that's been people have been telling you that it's been good for us for 20 years, and suddenly, oh no, that's bad. Don't eat that anymore. And you know, I love that. You know, life is food is bad for you.
Yeah,
you know?
Bad for your stomach. Yeah, it's you know, life is going to kill you. I'm afraid so. It's going to happen that way. But it's now a friend of mine is a pharmacist. And right now he's gone back to school. And he said to me, he says, you know what they told us in school? He says, 50% of the medical knowledge that we have today is wrong. And in 30 years, we're going to know that 50% of what we were telling people 30 years ago is wrong. The only problem is we just don't know which 50% it is.
Yeah.
So yes, there's something that's good for you is bad for you, and all that kind of stuff. So.
Did you want to go to a song?
Next? Yeah, let's go to another song here. Which one should we play here? Number two?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go to number two.
Mm-hmm. you're part of a losing team. A pyramid scheme, an impossible dream. Well, don't think that I don't know what you mean. But hang in there, yeah, hang in there. You may be hanging by a rope, but don't give up hope. Just hang in there. Misery's just a stop on the train. Don't let the battling rattle your brain. Stay undercover till after the rain and hang in there. Yeah, hang in there. Hang tough and take it, fake it till you make it. Yeah, hang in there. Your noble chin is starting to sag. Looks like you got left holding the bag. I know sometimes life can be a drag, but hang in there. Yeah, hang in there. You may be hanging by a rope, but don't give up hope. Just hang in there. Fate will finally see you through, and destiny wants to dance with you. Until then, all you gotta do is hang in there. Yeah, hang in there. Hang tough and take it, fake it till you make it. Yeah, hang in there. Train, don't let the battling rattle your brain. Stay undercover till after the rain and hang in there. Yeah, hang in there. Hang tough and take it, fake it till you make it. Yeah, hang in there. You may be hanging by a rope, but don't give up hope. Just hang in there.
Hang in There by Michael Goldman. And that's another original composition from Michael. Nice little tune. And he's got some more poetry for us. So why don't you take it away?
Thanks, Tom. So we just been reading some pretty humorous poems. I have a couple that more serious vein now. This first one is called Our Closest Dead. And this one has come up for me recently because of the holidays. And I'm sure that other people have had the same experience, that you sit around the holiday table at Thanksgiving or Hanukkah or Christmas coming up or whatever it is, and you notice who's not there. And Benny Andersen is reminding us that he's kind of saying, well, are they really not there? Or are they still there in some way? So this is called Our Closest Dead. Our closest dead are always close by us, follow us everywhere, take a lively interest in everything we undertake. Only in fateful matters do we ask for their advice. Immediately get a progress-invoking answer. None of them are deadbeats. They are happy to have brought us together, delighted that we have brought them together. They keep things humming, form a cheering section when we make love. Without our dearest dead, we would barely have met one another. Without our dearest dead, our lives would have stood half empty all year round.
All right. Without our dearest dead, yes, we wouldn't be what we are.
Yeah.
And they're with us. So.
And he's also, somehow they still influence us. And of course they do, because they are with us, inside of us, the experiences that we've had. And this time of year is a wonderful time, not just to be sad that they're not there, but to think, like Benny Andersen does, that, well, here they are.
Yeah.
Here they are again. So I wanted to at least do one poem as well. This is this poem is a little tongue-in-cheek, but it comments a little bit on the Danish national character. Because Benny Andersen, he is a Danish figure, a Danish icon of literature. And although, as we've heard tonight, his poetry really does translate really well to Western culture in the U.S. as well, this one has a little bit more of a North-South feel to it. And as the poem moves, you'll see him romanticizing about what it might be like to be in the South. Denmark is the far north, of Europe. So anyway, this is called The Real People. To travel away from the hot water bottle and pork sausage, travel out to the real places where the real people eat real food, live in real houses with real balconies, speak real, walk real, stop real, really get in trouble, have real children with real eyes, far from pork sausages and the hot water bottle. Down south, in the south, there's colors, atmosphere. All the houses resemble famous old paintings. All the people can sing and look like famous statues, often substitute for them. In the south, you drink wine. In the south, you're excitable all year round. In the south, you do everything out in the open, love, fight, live, whistle, die. Really, it's inborn. In the north, you have runny noses, cancer, envy. In the north, you walk around the puddles, around the statues, around one another. In the north, you drink milk. In the north, you have to think about your health. In the north, you're stiff with health. In the north, you're right. In the north, you don't budge an inch. In the north. In the north, you go south, where the real people have real cats, real lice, real teeth, sores, contrasts. You meet at the real places and hold real parties where the real blood rushes. Everyone knows one another, far from the hot water bottle and pork sausage.
Good stuff from Michael Goldman and Benny Andersen. Nice contrast there. Very cool.
And so there's the humor, which is, the humor is still present there, but there's also a real seriousness to it too, that in the North, we need to realize that we have, you know, maybe a little more of a stiff culture.
Yeah.
And it doesn't necessarily have to be that way, perhaps.
He
may be comparing Denmark to Italy. Or,
yeah, that's what I was feeling. I was feeling like Italy or Spain or something where people are just on fire all the time. And it's a little different here in Denmark. We're not quite like that.
Well, but you could also think about, try compare Maine to New Orleans
or
Rio.
Yeah.
We have a north-south on this side of the Atlantic.
I was definitely thinking that, too. Yeah. I was like, here we are in New England, and people are like, can't get there from here. No. And there's that laconic sort of reserve that New Englanders are known for.
That's right.
Whereas down south, you know, anybody will talk to anybody, sort of anything goes kind of sometimes. So it's a different world, different type of thing. So
I wanted to read a love poem as well.
Yes.
There's all these various themes that Benny Andersen sprinkles in throughout his huge body of work, and one of them is love poetry as well. And something that my wife Yet and I experienced when we were visiting Benny Andersen and sitting out in his back terrace with his wife and him was a beautiful garden with birds fluttering flying through the bushes and little sculptured trees, and everything's very manicured, and we saw him walking out to hang bread on the bushes for the birds, and it was just a really beautiful scene. And in this next poem, he takes part of his garden and kind of relates to it. Because his wife is away. This is called the Yellow Honeysuckle. The Yellow Honeysuckle. It is blooming at this very moment, the Yellow Honeysuckle. The little green caprifolium we put in the ground last year. It's blooming right now. Damned inconvenient. That sight you had been looking forward to, of scores of long, silent gold trumpets fanfares for the eyes. But not for yours, because you had to travel away for a time. So while you are away, I stand there early every morning and preach morals to the young honeysuckle. Don't get too carried away. Don't court your admirers too enthusiastically. Don't waste your entire youth all at once, so nothing is left that day my love comes home. Several times every day, yes, even late into the night, I have to go out as the stern father, chase away the bees and flies and moths. We know what happens when naive flowers get pollinated. Anesthetized, full and lazy, they throw off the rich colors of youth, retreat into themselves, and become boring. Endure a bit longer, my brave trumpets. Have patience, my uncontrollable little ones. Don't cast yourselves innocently before random passing acquaintances. Wait until the right one comes. Wait until my love comes home. You won't regret it. That day my love comes home, I will pluck clean every bush, every tree, every stem of bees and beetles, of butterflies and daddy long legs, of dragonflies and red admirals, of peacock butterflies and long-tailed skippers, maybe a single Adonis blue. I will strip banks and thickets of all types of erotic creepy crawlies and pepper you with worshippers. I foresee for you a huge joy if you can just hold out that long. I proclaim a dizzying orgy, the time of your life. We shall lack for nothing that day my love comes home.
Come home, love. That's beautiful.
You like that one?
I did. Yeah. I bet if my wife's listening, she would like that one too.
I mean, part of what I love about it, you know, it's about the plant. But you realize by the end of the poem that this doesn't have so much to do with the plant.
No,
this is about him, yeah. and that he, his feelings and he's transferring them to the plant. He's missing her terribly.
Yes, it's a wonderful longing in that piece.
I foresee for you a huge joy. But he's talking to himself too. Yeah. This is going to be a huge joy for me when she comes back.
Yeah.
When she comes back, we will lack for nothing, and if we can just hold out that long.
Yeah.
So it's one of my favorites.
I love that piece.
Yeah,
it's good. Yeah, so we've been sharing the poetry and translations, the poetry of Benny Andersen and the translations of Benny Andersen's poetry by Michael Goldman. And Michael's been reading for us. We've been playing music. We've been talking about the poetry. It seemed like there was one other subject we were going to discuss here. What was that? Remember?
Well, oh, right. I was going to just mention that I, as part of the advice that I got joining this Translators Association, was to look for money.
Yes.
For publishing.
Money is good.
And I applied for my first grant a few weeks ago, which was great advice.
Yeah.
It's through the Scandinavian American Foundation, the American Scandinavian Foundation, which is an organization that promotes a cultural exchange between Scandinavia, which includes Denmark, as well as Sweden, Norway, Finland, and the United States. And so Benny Andersen invited me to come back and work with him again, which is great.
Yeah.
And I will be in Denmark in the spring, and this time we'll probably have maybe a week together instead of just a couple days, and we'll go through the other 100 plus translations that we haven't gotten to yet. And I'm hoping that this grant will pay for my travel and stay there.
Wouldn't that be awesome if that happened?
Yeah, I won't know until the 1st of March.
Yes.
It's been a good experience, and I've had some help from the translators that I met at this conference.
Sure.
They helped me to get the application in, and just really appreciative of them.
We'll keep our fingers crossed for you. I hope it works out, because Let's just put it this way. Benny Andersen, he's very active still, but he's 83 years old.
Yeah.
And this, if it's going to happen, it needs to happen.
Yeah. So I wanted to make sure, I know we're getting close to the end of the show, I wanted to make sure we get in this Christmas poem.
Yes.
As far as I know, this is the only one I found in this book that's about Christmas. But Christmas is really big in Denmark. Yeah. Really big. It starts on December.
Huge.
It doesn't start on December 24th. It starts on December 1st.
Yeah.
And there's all kinds of celebrations every Sunday. This, you know, Advent Sunday. People have luncheons with their friends and businesses, and it's really a big time of year there. And this poem is about building up. It's about building up and preparing yourself for the month long holiday. And it's also another theme in his poetry, because he does have a fair number of occasional poems, poems that he's written for specific occasions. So this one, for Christmas, it's called Before Christmas. And that's appropriate for us today, too.
Yes, because it is before Christmas. It's coming. Christmas is coming.
Before Christmas, already the cotton tufts are tickling your nose. The pine is scratching you under the collar. Bottomless children's eyes pursue you everywhere. Big, strong men are separating tallow, remembering fluently their own and Peter's Christmas. Impossible to step on anyone's toes. Sparkling children and renewed adults forgive everything a month in advance. The heart becomes self-inflatable, swells with wish and thanksgiving. Though still held down by mammon ballast. Let go of what weighs on you. Shop for plenty and rise up liberated. Don't let down the child you once were, you once had, you once will be. If it's tickling in Bethlehem, then scratch yourself in Jerusalem. It's so simple to strew a little joy. Follow the nearest pine cone. Sing along. Hang on, because this year will be the Christmas of all Christmases. Mm-hmm.
Yes, it will. All right. So you have been listening to Twilight's Poetry Pub on WXOJLP Northampton, 103.3 FM Valley Free Radio. And we've been joined this evening by Michael Goldman, who's sharing poetry of Benny Andersen and his translations, and also some music, too. So, you have anything else to add here?
I just want to say that I really appreciate you having me on to share Benny Andersen's poetry and my experiences through the airwaves. I've been working on this project for a couple years, and I really my goal is that next year that it starts to turn into a book, and
yes,
that I make a contact with a publisher, and I just want to put that out there. That's what I want to happen.
Well, you have great dedication and enthusiasm for this project and talent, and now you've made this personal connection with Mr. Andersen, and I wish you all the luck in the world, and I'll be following it closely, and I'll be waiting for it to come out, and I'm sure a lot of our listeners will be also, so this is great.
Thank you very much for having me, Tom.
Thanks, Michael. Why don't we close it out with a little number from your CD here?
Thanks a lot, yeah.
Number 3, what is this one here? Do you know?
I think that is called I'm Not Going Anywhere.
Well, we are going somewhere, but we're not going anywhere. All right, have a great week, everyone.
Your past has been kind of rough, and today's still not quite good enough. Your dark moods I may not understand, though I may never quite understand. But I'm here, and I can hold your hand. So when your heart breaks open and you cannot speak, the waves swirl round you and your knees go weak. This whole earth's an island of sinking sand, yet somehow we found this place to stand. Well, I'm here, and I can hold your hand. So it's okay, go ahead and cry, I don't even have to know why. We've been through enough hard times, and with me there's no need to be shy. To see your eyes, let me brush back your hair. I hope you realize, I'm not going anywhere. No, I'm not going anywhere.
A heart's true love doesn't fade away just cause you've had a terrible day. I'm your lover, but also your friend, and pretty soon you'll be smiling again. And I'll be here to hold your hand. So it's okay, go ahead and cry. I don't even have to know why. We've been through enough hard times, and with me there's no need to be shy. To see your eyes, let me brush back your hair. I hope you realize I'm not going anywhere. No, I'm not going anywhere. I'm not going.